All right, so Trevor, we've got a new intro today.
That's right. How'd you make this?
How did I make it?
How did you make it?
The attorney who has the office down the hall from us got accosted by two individuals and pulled in here to borrow his voice.
That's right. I said, hey, Blake, you love to talk. Why don't you talk into this mic?
That's right. And then I just put some shots in there. For real. You want to see it?
I want to see it.
Do you want to see it?
I want to know what's going down.
All right. This is it right here.
You're now listening to the Check 2 Studio Podcast with your hosts, Austin and Trevor, bringing you the latest in video marketing and production.
There it is. I like it.
It was a very legal intro.
That's right. Attorney.
At law.
Blake Stewart. Stewart Law.
So good. I'm going to play it again.
Ready? Yeah, let's see it. Let's hear it. Let's experience it.
You're now listening to the Check 2 Studio Podcast with your hosts, Austin
Imperial
and Trevor, balloons, bringing you the latest in video marketing and production.
All animation.
Wait, I think I heard some Jagaloon talking throughout the whole thing that time. Was that you?
People can't see it. They need to experience it.
Oh, for the listeners.
Listeners.
Good point. So that brings me on to my next topic, which is another commercial we shot that we're going to do commentary of and talk about.
Yeah. Contractor, right?
It was a contractor. So this is episode 3 of the podcast. So we've already gone over the commercial we did for the Brevard Family Partnership, and we've gone over the commercial that we did for Wayne Anthony Insurance.
Mm-hmm. And we did some wedding, same day edit action.
We did talk about some wedding stuff on the first episode. And now we're going to be talking about this commercial we did for a contractor. Now you think this is a painting contractor. They paint residential.
Mostly residential.
Repaints.
Mostly exterior.
Yep.
Interior.
He doesn't do a lot of new construction. Just
No new repaints. Construction. So yeah, somebody buys a house, they want it to look nice, call him up, does a great job.
That's right. Now, repaints, that's like a whole other set of challenges because the surface could be like terrible. With new construction, you're painting a brand new surface.
Mm-hmm, drywall.
But we don't have to get it all about that.
Yeah.
Because we're not painters.
But before we get into actually shooting it, how we shot it, how we lit it, you know, we hit that a lot in the last two episodes. Let's talk about concept. Something that's creative, going to set him apart. There's a million contractors. He wants to set himself apart because the quality of the work speaks for itself, but reaching his customers, that's not easy.
Right. So we wanted to think of something that was going to get people laughing,
mm-hmm.
get some people remembering his name when they're out thinking about getting their houses painted.
They're like, man, my walls look terrible. I need them painted. I just saw a hilarious piece from Keenan Painting. I want to give them a call.
So you and I were at lunch and we were talking about, you know, what would be funny is what if you had somebody come to paint your house? And I'm sure this has probably happened to a lot of people. Just the worst guy in the world shows up to paint your house.
Just some buffoon who you can't trust. Now this guy's inside your house with your kid and your dogs, and that's not what you want.
Right. So what we did is we came up with an idea. It was a nightmare scenario. A couple hires a guy to paint their house. The guy shows up. He's got this crazy contraption that he claims is going to have the whole place painted in no time. And instead of that, catastrophe strikes. All hell breaks loose. Cats and dogs living together, mass hysteria type stuff. And I use a Ghostbusters reference for a very good reason, which we're going to find out in a minute.
That's right.
So should we just roll that beautiful bean footage?
Let's just see it.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and play the commercial so that our viewers can view it. And no talking for the next 30.
I'll keep it sealed. Just turn my mic off.
No. Just button it up, okay? Pal.
You're over 3 hours late. We could have had the whole place painted by now.
I got this.
I call this the paint suit. I'm gonna fire this puppy up. It's gonna have this room painted in no time.
Ah. You don't need a guy in a paint suit. You need someone suited to paint your house. Call the team over at Keenan Painting for a professional, courteous, and stress-free experience. They won't leave until you're 100% satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
Yeah. You open that up with a van, sketchy van. Then a gentleman is in your house. And man, that's not who you want in your house.
Right. So let's just jump into it here, shall we? Let's go here. So there's actually quite a lot of things to go over. We just go over this. This is the paint suit guy arriving.
Mm-hmm. Sketchy man.
Did you notice? Did you get the Ghostbuster influence with the suit, with the guy with the paint suit? He's got like a pack, like the Ghostbusters.
I got that, but we're in this scene right here.
Well, I wanted to have a callback to when I said that. So.
Okay.
So I went out and I shot this on a prior day. Got his exterior shot with his van. And we added some smoke in, and we put some sound design in, and let's watch the opening shot real quick.
Van pulls in.
You're over 3 hours late. We could have had.
All right, and then we're in the house immediately. Mm-hmm. I think that's an important note, the way to cut right in. We hear him talking before we get in. That's important.
Yeah, because we're trying to hit that 30-second mark, too.
That's true, but if you jump in all at once, it can be. That cut can be a little bit rough. It might not flow, so we kind of
needed that exterior.
You're over 3 hours late. We could have had the whole place painted.
There's no way he could already have been talking to him because he's still in the van, right?
Yeah, but it works. I mean,
well, that's a very common way to cut between two shots to kind of bridge the gap. So I was out there with a 24-foot jib arm, and that's how I got this shot. And in fact, is there behind the scenes in there of this one? I'm just going to click through the behind the scenes. I don't know if that behind the scenes shot is in there.
Yeah, because you took that one. But basically, we're seeing a house on a beautiful day with the van pulling up. Now, we really wanted a really sketchy van. And the really only thing sketchy about this van is the top of it. Unfortunately, you don't get to see a lot of it.
Pretty rusty. And I added the smoke, of course, and some clunky van sounds so that it would sound... like it was not running too well. And I added that screech of the brakes at the end. I don't know how many times we're going to watch this opening shot, but the van's pulling in.
3 hours late. We could have.
And it didn't really stop that fast. But when you add that sound effect to it, it kind of sells it like, oh.
Yeah, this guy is an animal.
And it's kind of got like late. Big floating shocks like trucks and vans have. So it kind of bounces like when it stops. It kind of jostles a bit.
Yeah.
So now we're inside.
We've been introduced to the couple who presumably would want to have their house painted, and they're not happy because he was already late.
Right. So we're trying to tell the story. We're trying to hit it home. The van's pulling in fast. It's smoking. And the first line is, you know, you're 3 hours late. So already we can see the guy's upset.
Mm-hmm.
And it really sells that this guy's unprofessional. He's got the mullet going on.
Well, so, yeah, we get our first look at the man in the paint suit and a slight notice that he's got something weird on his back.
Right.
But this guy has a mustache and a mullet.
Yeah.
And yeah, let's see what he says.
The whole place painted by now.
I got this.
So he kind of pulls him in. The homeowner's he's mad.
Yeah.
And he's the paint suit guy is just so cocky. He doesn't give a what. He's like shh.
He just tells him. Yeah, quiets him down.
I got this.
And in the original scene. The best part is the original scene was supposed to just be a finger. It was supposed to be shh on the lips. But as soon as the talent turned to look at his wife, which was, you know, the obvious thing of who you're going to complain to, he actually reached and kind of cupped the cheek. And we just had to go with that. But
I died on set when that happened. So
when that first went down.
This is my buddy Mike, who should be pretty familiar by now because I've put him in a lot. And I actually cast my wife, Sarah, and my best friend as a couple, because you do, as you do when you're in production. So he went to look like he does there, but really that was in the treatment that he would just be looking at the paint suit guy, and the paint suit guy would put a finger up against his lips and say, shh. But the actor knew that's what he was supposed to do, but he couldn't do it because Mike looked the other way. So he just... I don't know if he was just improvising or what. He just kind of grabs his face.
And we said, that's cold.
And I just fell about the place. We all did. Just laughing. And I said, okay, we're doing that. Even though that wasn't on the boards or anything. So he pulls him in. We dolly forward to really get intense.
Come tight.
Oh, yeah. I'm all about that dolly in on intense motion or intense moments
right.
to dolly forward because it just sells it so much. It just brings the audience in like, oh, man. And we dolly all the way into here. And, of course, I'm not using a dolly. Actually, we saw on a monopod for this.
Yeah.
But, you know, you loosen up the head and you can kind of pedestal or you can kind of dolly forward while tilting the head back so it maintains constant level.
We're just getting in.
And there's
intimate.
A little float to it, as you can see. It's not, you know.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of people ask us, they say, oh, man, I thought he was going to kiss him on the lips. People, like, this is the first point of, I mean, you see the mullet, but when they're really getting close, like, now, you know, things are getting weird.
That would have really been like a Bugs Bunny, Who Framed Roger Rabbit type of gag if you just kissed him.
Yeah.
Might have been a little too weird
for our client.
Mike could have been, he could have done like the Bob Hoskins, like when Roger Rabbit kisses him. That could have been a great moment. Maybe next time.
Yeah. And we get another real good look at the business in the front and the party in the back.
Right. So that mullet is real.
It's a real mullet. How did you find this guy?
So let me go ahead and tell the story on that. So this is a guy who I went to high school with. His name is Devin. He never acted before. He'd never done anything like this before. And him and his buddies were hanging out at the bar, and he had longer hair, longer than mine is now. And he was going to get a haircut. But as a joke, he was going to, just for one day only, cut it into a mullet so he could go to the bar with a mullet and just make everybody laugh. And then he made the mistake of posting that on Facebook. And I happened to see it, and I said, whoa, he's at a bar right now with this mullet. So I didn't have his number, and I messaged him, and I said, hey, are you going to – can you keep that mullet? Because I have a commercial we're producing, and we're going to hire an actor, but you look the part. Would you be interested in coming in and auditioning? And he's like, sure. And it ended up being another 3 weeks before we shot, so he had to keep that mullet for a good month.
Yeah, we hit some delays because the painter was very busy, and we needed his crew there for some other things. And
we were going to sit him with our acting coach because he wasn't an actor, but he didn't need it. I figured, you know what, I talked to him a little bit. We had a meeting, and I kind of told him the idea for the script, and I had him read it right there in the Starbucks where we were. And I said, you know what? I think I could just direct this guy on set and get a performance that's going to be convincing. So that's what I did. And he did a fantastic job. And he was really excited to be a part of the process. He'd never done anything like that before.
Mm-hmm.
So the only thing, he didn't even really mind keeping the mullet for a month. So let's watch on.
I got this.
I call this the paint suit.
This is some VFX lighting there, or I'm going to call it VFX. I added this in post, and that is a real LED strip, and I had planned to do that. I obviously built the whole thing, and I was going to add some lights, and, you know, I'm just gluing stuff on, and I just glued those on there, and then later I said, you know what, I can just light them in post, and I don't have to worry about doing any soldering.
So talk about that. You pull up some of these behind-the-scenes photos now that we're kind of in it.
All right, so what do you want to see first? You want to talk about lighting or more
on
the
props?
Well,
let's see the whole paint suit first. There should be some photos in there that's just the paint suit. It might be at the bottom.
Let me see if I can find a good shot of the whole thing there.
Because I edited a few, just called paint suit.
Okay, yeah, I see some here. Yeah, here we go. So that's kind of the full thing.
In all its glory.
In all of its glory. So it's 2-liter bottles, spray painted silver. We got a surge projector, multimeter here. These are the free multimeters that Harbor Freight gives out like every couple of months.
Yeah.
I had like a drawer of these, and I was in the
drawer.
Yeah.
Every time you went there, you just said, "I'll take one."
No, I literally have 4 or 5 more of these, just because they give them. They like some months it's scissors, others these like little LED work lights, and sometimes it's these surge projectors.
And you just take them. You don't just say, "I'm good."
Multimeters.
I have enough.
No.
You
I take
say,
them.
I want it.
I say, where's my multimeter? I've got a drawer of them at home.
And
I never know when I'm going
to
be building a prop or something. Well, it's, I, I used to have a prop, like when I was building more props, I used to just have like bins of greeblies or just things.
Random.
Yeah. Widgets. And a lot of that's this, like there's heat sinks on here. There's like a syringe. There's just a bunch of an eclectic bunch of stuff. And then the same way the Ghostbusters packs were made, this is an Alice pack. And they built from the, you know, a little bit more elaborate of a design, obviously, for the Ghostbusters. For this, I didn't have a big budget to work with. I didn't actually spend, the only money I spent, we bought the Alice pack for $40 and the jumpsuit.
It was like 50.
And a can of spray paint. And that's all. Because all the rest of this stuff.
It's pretty frugal.
I still have a lot of bits and pieces for doing props. So I just, you know, all the wiring and all that stuff, I just had that stuff laying around. I had some of this striped tape that's very Mythbusters looking. And
yeah. And you don't even see the whole suit, really. The most you see the suit is in that other shot there. But you put it all together.
You're right. I want to look at this slightly wider shot of the same thing here. Oh, there we go. And look at Mike. And Sarah, she's there. So yeah, I built the suit, and so we'll go back, and there it is in the piece. You see little heat sinks here, some tubing, some coiled wire. Anybody in the comments, if you recognize this piece right here, maybe a special prize for you or something. I'll find something to send you if you guess what that is right there. So get a good look at that.
You'll probably see more of those.
Yeah, there's props. A couple of them right here, but I always put one of those when I build a prop as a good luck charm. There's one of those in my R2 as well. So, so that's the suit. Let's watch on.
I'm going to fire this puppy up. It's going to have this room painted in no time.
Another little bit of compositing there. Nothing hard, anybody could do this. I didn't even go into After Effects for any of the compositing in this. I did it all in Final Cut, even the smoke, everything. So you get the little overload. That was added in post. This shake is added in post, and so is the zoom, the little zoom. It kind of zooms in, and then there's this composite of this explosion. So there's a couple of things going on here. This smoke that's coming out, that was added in post. So I masked him out and added the feathered edge and had that smoke. And then that's obviously, this is actually, I can't remember, but there's like glass and stuff in this explosion. Like, it doesn't make any sense if you think about it real hard, but maybe like there's glass and some glass.
In the suit,
and I don't know. I don't know what this guy.
Those 2 liter bottles are actually.
There's a line that's cut, I think, from the commercial where he says, I made it myself.
Yeah.
But that didn't make it into the shot. But he does say that he built the suit himself. That's a little backstory for you guys. So yeah, if you kind of pause through this explosion, you see like big chunks of glass. Did you know that was in there before?
I did notice there were some weird other artifacts that couldn't have been the actual suit stuff that was exploding, and it wasn't just like white specks
exploding. And then obviously that's not VFX, that's real.
And we had, I knew we
no,
were
don't tell this. Them what that
I'm
is.
Not
That's
them.
The other. We're giving 2 prizes away in this episode. One is whoever guesses what this white stuff is that we put on their face. And the other one is if they remember that little piece of that prop that I talked about earlier.
Yeah, well, the disbursement of that stuff, that white stuff, I knew we only had one take. This is actually at
you
the talent's
guy in a
house. And he was in the process of restructuring and painting and doing some other things. But to keep everything, I don't know, we couldn't have done it twice. It made an enormous mess.
We had one take.
One take, and it had to be as good as we could make it.
So we have a behind the scenes. Let's see if I can just play it here. There we go. And then after this, we're going to have to get into some of the lighting real quick, too. So this is a behind the scenes of that take.
Hey, everybody, you guys are looking at the machine. It's making sound. 1, 2, 3, go.
So I was upset because I thought that the bowls were in the shot more than I wanted them to be. And I didn't know if I could cover it with the VFX. So, and I knew that we weren't going to do it again. So I knew I was going to have to come up with some solution. So you can hear a little bit of my disappointment.
Like the whole shot. Both of them.
Okay. Oh. So at that moment, you know, I'm thinking like, okay, well, I know when I get into the editing chair, I'm going to have
some work,
something to do, but this explosion covers it completely. I don't even think if you go frame by frame, you can see any of the bowl.
Hmm.
Is there like a little of your hand right here holding the bowl? I don't think so.
No.
I like, if you look close at Mike's mouth, he actually like got it in his mouth. So he spits it.
You don't need it.
All right. So now that we've done that, let's go through some of the lighting here. This was a very tight room as well for all of our equipment. Here's a nice wide of the room. It kind of shows what we were dealing with here. And you can just see all the things with the 120D.
Mm-hmm. This time with the light dome.
With the light dome on it. We had Colin on set. He comes in, does some gaffing work for us on the side. You see, we've got Apple boxes down here. We've got the works.
That's right, our B&H Apple boxes. Matthew.
And I think if I had this all over to do all over again, I wouldn't have done the hair lights in mixed color. Because there was too much spill on the other actors. I probably wouldn't do that again. Mm-hmm. I think it's fine because the way we color graded the final shot is we went pretty grimy with it. I think that's after it's black and white. But you see, it's pretty green. It's pretty, you know, it's pretty dark. So I think it's okay. It kind of sells that color palette. We've got the green and the yellow. It's just kind of like, paint suit guys at my house. It's terrible. So I think it works. But, you know, you're never 100% satisfied. If you're a true artist, you're always like, wanting more, you're wanting it better, right? So
right.
I think, you know, I'm getting myself a fair shake on that, but we are very happy with it. And let's talk while I look for another good behind the scenes, why don't you talk a little bit about the reception, how this played when we put this out into the world, while I look through these.
Yeah, so as we were working on this and getting ready to figure out what is the release strategy going to be, the owner really wanted us to display it at a local group that he's a part of. So we were able to take over of what is usually a very valuable opportunity for him to promote his own business. He said, I want you two guys to come in, set it up, premiere it for this little networking group and explain how you did it and just really talk about it. And that was really awesome for us. And it was great, very well received. And so far, now that it's out in the world, it's been... you know, people are very happy about it. It's about to be used for Facebook ads and YouTube ads, possibly TV and movies as well. Movie theater.
Oh, okay. They're putting this in the movies,
not,
dude.
They're not making a movie about the paint suit guy, but I think he could hold it. He's got the personality.
Paint suit the movie?
Paint suit the movie. Well, I think it would just be whatever his name is.
What is the paint suit guy's name? How about that's our third... contest.
Name the paint suit guy.
Name.
Because guess what? There's already going to be a second and possibly a third part of this campaign.
Right.
And we may need to know his name.
So let's talk a little bit about that for a minute, because other companies, like we did an insurance commercial with Madam Liability. Mm-hmm. Really great episode of the podcast, episode number 2.
That's right.
Go back and watch that if you already watched that. You know, we talked about flow, like in Progressive, like that character was there, or the Geico Lizard, like they put that commercial out, but that campaign continues to this day, both of them.
Mm-hmm.
The client wants more of the paint suit guy. So we have a couple of concepts. We won't give them away now, but keep a lookout because the paint suit guy might be making a return in a second commercial for this company.
And you already have the concepts for number 2 and number 3.
I have them, but I'm not giving away.
80 to 90% of it already storyboarded, figured out.
It's true. So here, let's take a look at this behind the scenes photo. We'll just kind of break it down. So we've got some backlight on the talent to separate them out from this very tiny room. You can see how small the room is. We don't have a lot of room. That 120D takes up a lot.
Yeah.
And to keep that from spilling on the background, it was impossible to do that. But, you know, we've got actually some neg on top of it. That's just like a flag from a flag kit, some negative fill from a flag kit that we took off the frame and just kind of draped it off there because so much was spilling on the background in this tiny room. It was just impossible. And then it was just difficult to get the actors separated from the background. So we had to work on that. We have on the C-stands here, we have some panels. This is for their hair light, backlight, kicker light, whatever you want to call it. And then we also, you know, at the end of that, I still felt like there needed to be something. And then also down here, we see apple boxes. The paint suit guy was pretty tall.
Yeah.
So to make it, you know, in that tight room, I couldn't really move around a lot. So I had to really get them all close enough in height to where the frame would work.
And his other inspiration was Joe Dirt. So it didn't work if he was gigantically tall, towering over them.
Oh, right. So let's talk about this on the wall over here. I felt like it was just too plain back there. I still don't know if this is a good idea, a bad idea, or what. I mean, I like it, especially for the dark, dingy look we're going for. I'm going to go back and see these shadows behind them on that of that wine shelf.
You go to the wide, maybe you see it?
Yeah, you'll see it in the first shot. So, see that? We have a spotlight shining through that onto the wall.
Blue gel.
It just was really plain back there. Like, yeah, he's a paint suit guy's got the weird picture.
Spooky look because the light is coming from so low, but it is just weird.
But look at this whole scene.
I know.
It's just dingy. It's weird. So I got that little extra bit of texture back there. Make of it what you will. But, you know, it's just think of it. It's one of the many ways you can be creative on set. And I think, down here in the bottom right, let me shorten this. I don't think I can get it all the way up into our. There we go. Down here, you see that spotlight with the blue gel shining through these wine glasses, creating that weird kind of effect, fun house, Tim Burton-y kind of look.
That's true.
Hey, that's what you do. You get on set and you experiment because, like we said, we're not the end-all, be-all, you know. We are not yet the products we hope to be. We are improving ourselves all the time. Trying to learn, and we're not afraid to go out and experiment.
Problem solve.
And our clients know what we do. Our clients like what we put out. And, you know, we have a signature touch to everything. And then we're, you know, in our market here, people are starting to know, like, oh, Austin must have done that. You know? Austin and Trevor must have came in here. That's an
ideal impact media piece right there. So you are here coaching the talent. You are not only the director of photography, envisioning and setting up the lighting. You imagine the concept, but you're also coaching the talent on how to deliver this piece. I took this photo, and there you are.
Right. So I'm the director of these pieces. That's and whether I want that role or not, you know, I'm definitely the DP. I'm definitely getting the image, but I'm also directing the actors. And because this was my idea, this was my concept, you know, I wrote the commercial. So I have an idea in my head how I want people to say them. And it's very challenging for me to direct the actors. I think it's supposed to be challenging. I don't think it's supposed to be easy. But you know, I'm constantly trying to revamp my approach. I'm trying to do, you know, I'm trying to explain things as clearly, and I'm trying my very best not to frustrate them. Cause you can imagine like take after take after take for a non-actor. They're like, you know, what are they thinking? Are they thinking like he hates it? So, I watch making of movies a lot. And one of the things I hear James Cameron say a lot is, loved it, loved it, loved it. Do it again.
Yeah.
So I always copy that. I always say, I loved it one more time. Because I want them to know that I'm happy with what they're doing. And then the other tendency I have, criticism of myself, is I tend to try to act it out for them so they can copy me. And that, I don't think that's a good approach. So I try to, rather than that, I try to tell them like, well, like, imagine this just happened and you're feeling like this. Like, that's, I feel, like a better approach.
Right, so they can be a little bit more natural.
But keep in mind, that's
a lot to draw from.
That's going
to
be something that's going to help trained actors.
Right, right.
Because they can tap into that. Mm-hmm. Whereas when you're working with non-actors, sometimes you do have to kind of give them something to copy. So I would tell them, like, you know, I would go in and I would kind of act it out for them. Like, you know, say it like this. And I would kind of be like, I call this the paint suit. And, you know, and then he would, you know, try to
do his best to, yeah.
Yeah, but then I try to keep it to a minimum still. Like I said, like, I'm learning. These are non-actors, or he's a non-actor. These other guys are getting a lot of experience, and Sarah's done some work. So, but, yeah, just trying to work with them, get the best performance, and then take what's in my – I'm trying to translate my idea to the screen. That's all we're doing is we're taking this concept, and we're translating it in a language that works on screen. So that's what we did. Let's take a look at another one. The wides and the tights, we kind of lit it in a way that, you know, we didn't have to change a lot from the wides to the tights because they're kind of standing in a semicircle.
Yeah.
There you go. So there goes the boom pole.
Yeah, and I'm going to say right now one of our weakest points is audio.
Yeah, 100%.
We really got to bring our audio game up and, you know, have a higher standard on how we can improve that. And some people, as we've put this out, other filmmakers, that's kind of been their biggest critique, is the audio is not really at the same level as the production and the creativity and the concept and the camera movement and all of that. So,
and it's really, and you know, once they say it, you know, I kind of think to myself, like, ah, I do spend all my energy thinking about the image.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in real life, or I say in the real world of production, the way we're doing things, you know, we're in a small market, we're a small company.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the times it's you and me,
right,
filming. And we might have, in this case, we had Colin, so or we might have Tavion.
Yeah.
But usually it's you and me,
mm-hmm,
and the actors. And we are the ones that carried all the equipment in. We're the ones that set up all the light. We're the ones behind the camera. We're the ones doing everything. And we're the ones packing it all up and taking it home and hopefully walking away with a memory card that has something on it we need.
That we can edit into something worth showing.
So, you know, in the real world of doing things, there'd be a DP, there'd be a director, you'd have assistants, you have gaffers, you'd have all these people, you'd have sound people.
Engineer, audio engineer.
Right. Even just a boom guy. We don't have that. You're holding the boom pole.
Right. And trying to be a producer and trying to... Right. Keep other things in line.
And I think that's important for people to know, and they look at us specifically, is that, hey, you know, we're not coming from some big ad agency. I'm not a DP that was brought in by a big production, you know. It's not like that. We are giving this stuff to the people that are on our level or below,
mm-hmm,
and saying, hey, you know what, our market, nobody in our market really produces high-quality television commercials, so... like they don't pay for them. So before us, it was us or nothing, basically.
Yeah, right.
They're not going to spend $50,000, $60,000.
Right.
And until we get to the point of doing those projects, this is what you get.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we're going to get a sound guy, or maybe we're going to keep running and gunning like we've been doing. But that's what we do. We try to do our best. We try to light the scenes. We try to write funny concepts, and we try to do everything the best we can. And this level of filmmaking is becoming accessible to more people. The camera, like we said, we're using Sony A7S2s. We're using, you know, we're using stuff that people can afford. So you're going to see smaller markets start to have access to having creative content.
Capability, like, yeah.
Yeah.
Really,
like if you're a kid out there listening to this, get a camera, come up with a concept, try to learn as much as you can about lighting, and go out don't try to take on a Nike ad at first, because you probably won't get it.
Right.
Take on some stuff and then keep pushing to that higher level.
And don't settle for just what your camera's pointed at. Control the light, control the audio, think and plan. I think that's the number one thing. A lot of people have their phone. They think, oh, this has a 4K camera. And that's great. You can get a great image out of a phone. But if you've planned and you've put the work in, you can really maximize what even the cheapest sensors can do.
It's true. And one thing that I'm kind of proud of ourselves for is we've never blamed our equipment. Like, mm-hmm, oh, we don't have this, we don't have that. When we have nice equipment, I like what we have. I like the cameras are nice and you can get a good image. But, you know, we don't put the blame on the equipment, because at the end of the day, I've seen professional looking stuff come out of Canon T3Is,
mm-hmm,
you know, and all kind of stuff. So the stuff is there. You just have to work within the confines of knowing what you have. And you can go and you can put out a piece like this that's gotten a lot of attention for the client. He's very, very happy with it.
Yeah.
And wants to continue the campaign. And no other painting companies on his level in the area have anything like this. They don't even have nothing. So this puts him out in front.
And the other thing is, as you help your clients, as we help businesses and they see the return on investment, that allows them to have bigger and bigger budgets for better and better projects. And we're building a relationship and building a reputation, and it allows you to continue to level up. But it requires learning. And that's what we want to do here, is share what we know, and we want to hear what you guys think of how we did it. Maybe you're seeing something that's an easy fix that maybe we should have considered. So definitely hit us up. Leave comments. We want to know what your thoughts are.
Right. So now I'm going to make a few announcements for the podcast. So this is episode 3. It's high time they know what's going on around here. If they're still with us now after 35 minutes of this podcast, we're going to continue to break down our work. And we're trying to come up with a monetization strategy, you know, YouTube being what it is, with the adpocalypse and all this other stuff that has happened. We've set up a Patreon. And what we're going to do is we're going to give every other episode for free on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And all the odd-numbered episodes after a certain time. Right now, they're all free on YouTube. But the odd-numbered episodes are going to be patrons only. And patrons set it, the Patreon perk. If you're,
what about episode 1? That's odd.
Yeah, and so it's this one. This is 3.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. Like, when we get it fully set up. Right now, they're all free. All right. So, but we're going to set that up, and we're going to have patron perks. One of the Patreon perks is going to be, you know, you can submit your work to us, and we'll go through it on the show like we do. We won't have behind the scenes, but we'll talk about it. We'll critique it, tell you what you think. So, brave only apply. I bet your people submit some dope work to us to look at. So, if you're interested in having that, or if you're, you know, just you'll have to pay attention, and there'll be more info to come as we continue to put these podcasts out. But there'll be the Patreon, and there'll be perks that are going to be fun.
Yeah.
So stay tuned.
And there's going to be some more wedding stuff in here too. We'll hit a little bit on that.
Right.
And we're also going to talk about the marketing side, bringing this home, how it's going to affect your clients. We're going to continue to hit on that because you could have the greatest vision in the world, but if you can't deal with people, then, you know, you're not gonna be able to get any work. So we'll hit on that, but I think that's going to be a lot more Patreon specific because we really want to be more one-on-one or small group on that, but keep an eye.
You know what?
I think you're right.
All right.
You covered up our faces. What's going on here, dude?
What are you trying to say here? I said we're silly people.
That's true. Oh, wow. Now you can't even, I'm not even moving.
All right. Your camera's frozen. I'm frozen. He's frozen. I think we reached our point.
So what would you say?
I would say shoot first.
Ask questions later.